This video contains mentions of sexual harassment, workplace abuse, transphobia, racism, and suicide. If any of these are triggers to you, please proceed with caution. On Wednesday, July 21st, 2021, the state of California filed a lawsuit against video game company Activision-Blizzard with allegations of discrimination, sexual harassment, racism, and more. Dozens of horrible first-hand accounts leaked from current or former employees, most of which already have been reported on countless times in the past 1 or 2 months, with each new bit of information only making the case sound worse and worse. An IGN article claimed that men would peep on women in their assigned breastfeeding room at a Blizzard studio. A Vice report spilled that an Activision IT worker hid a camera in a unisex bathroom. The company's law firm is one that historically pushes against workers' rights, and we even learned that Activision Blizzard's HR department was shredding important documents ahead of this suit. There is a treasure trove of other terrible misdeeds that you can find with a simple Google search, but there's one particular piece of information that is sinister in a different, less direct way. On the morning of July 21st, the very same day that the lawsuit would become public, Activision Blizzard announced a Crash Bandicoot 25th anniversary bundle that contained 5 beloved games for the price of 1. While the Crash series was only acquired by Activision in 2008, it is nonetheless one of their most beloved IPs, with the Insane trilogy in particular selling 10 million copies in just over 2 years. People want to play Crash Bandicoot, and Activision wants people to play Crash Bandicoot, because people's nostalgia for Crash Bandicoot will distract them from a massive controversy that would hit the trades later that day. And after the news did drop, and all of official ActiBlizz Twitter accounts went silent for weeks, the first one to return to posting was, you guessed it, the Twitter account for Crash Bandicoot. Of course, I am not going to downplay the feelings that people have for the Crash Bandicoot series, or the Spyro the Dragon series, or Overwatch, or Diablo, or even Call of Duty. Each of them have been around for a long time, influencing our childhoods, our taste in games, and even our lives as a whole. I know I've met a lot of friends through gaming and fandom spaces myself, even if in my case it's not through any of those particular franchises. But you cannot deny that most works of art are also commercial products for a massive company, one that will not hesitate to use their products as distractions from real-life issues. It has happened time and time again, both in and out of the gaming sphere. Disney permanently lays off hundreds of their employees rather than furloughing them during a pandemic. Frozen 2 is releasing on Disney Plus early. Hundreds of allegations come out about Ubisoft's toxic work culture. Oh, let's announce that Scott Pilgrim re-release. These are attempts to distract you, to coax you into supporting a conglomerate rather than listening to important information, and unfortunately, these schemes tend to work. When a company pretends to be your friend with a performative gesture, it's not usually out of the goodness of their hearts. Video game mascots are not real people. Obviously, they are fictional characters. Yes, they are from works of art that can be important to us, which in of itself is perfectly valid. But that attachment can also leave one feeling dirty when finding out that the art you enjoyed was born out of real-world suffering, almost as if you found out that a friend of yours was a shitty person. One's first instinct might be to rationalize said enjoyment, saying that you'll still buy a game to support the devs, or that another company should buy the character so you can enjoy it guilt-free, or even that there's no such thing as ethical consumption under capitalism, so it doesn't matter if one person buys one game. All of these are, like I said, rationalizations. They don't address the root of the issues or the consequences of one's actions, they just sidestep the issue entirely to justify continued engagement with logic that doesn't hold up under any scrutiny. Yet, each of these attitudes are incredibly pervasive, especially in gaming spaces. When the ActiBlizz news began to spread, one of the first trends to pop up was Crash and Spyro, full of fans touting those exact ideas. I'm not saying every Crash or Spyro fan did this, of course, but there were a number of users prioritizing the safety of an intellectual property over the safety of real-life victims, which is tasteless at best, and actively harmful at worst. Removing oneself from the reality of a situation to mindlessly indulge in a commercial product is exactly what companies hope for. So I want to examine where exactly these rationalizations come from, why they don't work when actually put into practice, and how we can better engage with these works without simply letting the company win. Because no matter where the art comes from, there will always be the burning question, can one ethically support a quote-unquote problematic developer? As expected, the answer is extremely complicated and requires a lot of nuance and discussion. Howdy folks, I'm Jenny Geist, and before we dive into the nitty-gritty of these specific arguments, I first want to give a couple disclaimers. To begin with, I am not an end-all be-all authority on this subject. This is just one random take from one random YouTuber, not an inflexible divine rule of what is right and what is wrong. I am simply speaking from my own experiences as a bisexual and transgender white woman. If you come away disagreeing with my philosophy, that's fine. If you come away agreeing, maybe we can start a matching t-shirt club or something. I also want to make it clear that I am not trying to make anyone feel bad about their specific tastes or experiences. If you've enjoyed Crash or Spyro or Rayman or Mario Plus Rabbids or any other series owned by a company that could be deemed problematic, that is fine by me. I'm just using these specific examples because they're relevant and could lead to a larger point about the gaming industry. When I say Crash or Spyro here, I could swap that out with any other property and the same principles would apply. I am not setting out to shit on any specific property or person because they're problematic. But on that note, we should also probably define what problematic even means in this context. When it comes to the term problematic, though, we should first address the elephant in the room, because the word has been thrown around so much these days that it has basically lost all meaning. Saying that someone is problematic can mean anything from this person says racial slurs to this person ships Zutara. And in the current state of social media discourse, these two very different behaviors are basically treated as one and the same, both requiring the same amount of vitriol and malice. It's not enough to just dislike something. The things you dislike must be super problematic for one reason or another, while the things you like are 100% pure, which in general is a very bad attitude to hold. It's cliche to say at this point, but there are no truly pure works of fiction that will fully match your specific ideology, and consuming popular media inherently requires some form of dissonance. An acceptance that, yeah, I'm not going to agree with every idea presented by this work, or every practice used in its creation, because only consuming works that agree with me is boring, and only consuming works that are 100% ethical is near impossible. Plus, we've all known at least one person who gets very extreme about the things they deem problematic and acts like anyone who gets the slightest enjoyment from it is automatically approving of every terrible thing in said media. You know, like that guy in the Onion article who goes out of his way to tell people that John Lennon beat his wife, where they're not really pushing any sort of productive praxis, and they're not spreading the information because they care. No, it's about feeling smug and superior. Trying to define morality based off the things that people enjoy is just kind of rude in general, and if you're going to criticize something, you need to have something more to say than just capitalism bad, so think bad. If you want to dive further into this equally terrifying rabbit hole, I highly recommend watching Sarah Zed's fantastic video on the subject. After you're done with this one, of course. All of this is to say that problematic is not exactly the most useful word, but it's also the most ubiquitous one we have for these types of contexts. As loose as this term's meaning has become, the connotation it holds can be relevant in certain instances, especially when it pertains to large-scale corporate issues that are otherwise difficult to sum up in one word. Obviously, nothing produced by a multi-million-dollar corporation is going to have no strings attached, but there are certainly cases that are more blatantly evil, or at least more well-known than others, and that is absolutely the focus here. So, just as a guideline, when I say something is problematic in this video, I mean more in the line of the things I talked about in the intro rather than stuff like shipping Raylo. This is about the very serious and preventable issues that plague the industry, not dumb, petty Twitter bullshit. Individual solutions to systemic problems are not possible. And on that note, one of the first and most popular retorts when a studio is found to be abusive or a higher-up is found to be bigoted is, "I'm still buying a game to support the devs." The idea is that, while one does not support the actions of the bad people involved, they still want to purchase the game to assist the many innocent employees who have also worked hard on the project. Video games are an extremely collaborative art form, so it is true that a large chunk of the workers in these famously corrupt studios have likely done nothing wrong and just want to pump out a solid experience. It really sucks that an honest, hard-working person might handle the visual design for something like Beyond Two Souls, only for the rug to be pulled out from under them when the higher-ups treat Elliot Page like shit and David Cage is David Cage. This leaves some fans to ponder the question of, should their work go unrewarded just because of circumstances that are far out of their control? And yeah, not everyone who worked on a game is one of the shitty people that you hear about on the news, and the people who did put hard work into it deserve some sort of support. But arguably, and I know this sounds a bit contrarian, they did get paid for their work as it was happening through their regular salary. Contrary to what some seem to believe, the money that a company earns from a game sale does not get distributed fairly to every single employee. Most are paid a salary that is received throughout each project's 3 to 6 year span, and overall, the majority of developers do not get royalties. By the time a game hits store shelves, most coders, artists, QA testers, writers, and so on have already received all of the financial support they will get from a project. There are obviously other important issues within the setup, such as unpaid overtime or wage gaps between cishet white employees and their queer, female, or non-white counterparts, or bonuses being withheld if a game doesn't reach a certain Metacritic threshold, but the general fact of the matter is that game devs are already supported through their existing salary. Purchasing a game is only really supporting devs through the lens of enjoying the underappreciated work of the artists, coders, sound designers, etc., which I do also understand. There is an insane amount of work that goes into making a big budget video game, and it is a shame that so much of it often goes ignored even in the best of cases. Moreover, it is all too common for a company to produce one too many flops in a row and then go under entirely, causing hundreds of employees to lose their jobs after years of backbreaking hard work. The fact that so many people have lost their livelihoods because of this industry's fragile employment structure is absolutely horrible, but at the same time, it's never the consumer's responsibility to keep a studio in business. If someone doesn't want to buy a game because it's missing a multiplayer mode, or it doesn't run at 60 frames per second, or it makes story decisions that one might disagree with, people don't really question it. Why would you? That is a personal decision that is frankly nobody else's business. But when somebody says they're not buying a game because the company behind it has abusive practices, or a famously bigoted individual is profiting from it, there's always the aforementioned retort of what about supporting the devs? I'm not speaking theoretically either, this is an extremely common reply in my own experience, as if it's a gotcha to change someone's mind about boycotting a specific brand. Ignoring the fact that we shouldn't question people's purchasing decisions, even if they are related to a social issue, the argument is just kind of disingenuous in general. Again, we as consumers have no responsibility to keep any creative work afloat, especially when a lot of the issues that lead to mediocre games are caused by fully preventable mismanagement. Take how CD Projekt Red's development of Cyberpunk 2077 was a crunch-filled disaster, resulting in the final product being a buggy, unfinished, poorly received mess. Meanwhile, Insomniac's development of Ratchet & Clank Rift Apart was reportedly crunch-free, resulting in a well-received and well-balanced experience. So yeah, supporting mismanaged and often abusive studios to help the devs is false logic from either point of view. If you're doing it because you want to help the little guy, it does the opposite, as the company's inappropriate behavior will be rewarded with a profitable game, which removes any incentive for them to improve in the first place. See how Cyberpunk 2077's development was the way it was after The Witcher 3 had an equally bad process and released to critical acclaim. If you're doing it because you want to support the artistry of the little guy's work, consider that their talent is being stunted by the practices that buying it would support. See how Rift Apart was much better received than the previous Ratchet & Clank games, many of which were crunched out in a short time frame and didn't gain much traction. I should note that Insomniac has their own issues that I will get into later, but yeah. I'm definitely not trying to claim that people who have thought in this mindset are actively malicious or anything. I understand why some feel a desire to help the devs who suffered so much to create something they enjoy. I just also think the exact thought process of I am buying a game to support the devs doesn't really hold up in this current capitalist environment. A company is not going to know one's personal reasoning for buying a game. They're just going to see a sale, a validation that what they're currently doing is a-okay in the eyes of the consumer, which does the exact opposite of help the devs. You cannot stop a capitalist problem by partaking in capitalism. That's just not how it works. Anyway, let's talk about Miku.
Ladies and gentlemen, please welcome making her network television debut, Hatsune Miku.
Another similar argument I often see to justify one's own purchases is the Miku-made Minecraft approach, which, for those who are lucky enough to not have heard it, originated from a Twitter account known as Miku Ebooks, who in 2019 joked that Hatsune Miku was the original creator of Minecraft, as opposed to the infamously bigoted real-life creator named Notch. It was an offhand joke that gained a lot of popularity at the time, partially because Notch is no longer involved in the franchise at all. In 2015, Minecraft was sold off to Microsoft, so the original creator could no longer profit from or even work on the game at all, and the current developers at at Mojang have since then distanced themselves from him entirely. Notch may have gone full mask-off misogynist, but his voice is no longer reflected in his creation, as references to him have now been removed from the game, and the new team has made public strides for women's and LGBTQ rights among their user base. Thus, the thought of Miku replacing Notch as the original creator is pretty funny and relatively harmless, since buying a copy of Minecraft is not putting money in the hands of a horrible person with a large audience. Compare this to the Harry Potter series, where in response to J.K. Rowling's immense transphobia, some have made a similar joke claiming Miku is the new author of those books. This does not work as well for a number of reasons. For one, J.K. Rowling's views and the narrative of Harry Potter work hand in hand. Neither exist in a vacuum, and neither should be analyzed that way. Several other video essayists have done much more in-depth analyses of the racism, transphobia, anti-Semitism, and general centrist attitudes of the series, so I won't get into it here, but rest assured, the series cannot be separated from J.K. Rowling, at least not when she still directly profits from her work. Every book purchase, Fantastic Beasts ticket sale, and theme park butterbeer served is directly putting money into the pockets of a woman who is using her massive influence to actively damage the rights of a marginalized group. The single most famous author of the past 30 years is using her fame to lobby dangerous legislation that can and will lead to the deaths of trans people in the United Kingdom. So you can't just pretend Miku wrote Harry Potter, because that sidesteps the consequences of spending money on Harry Potter. Also, this Miku music no longer feels appropriate. Let me change that real quick. The same principle applies in a different way to the works of Activision, or Ubisoft, or EA, or Nintendo, or any other video game company ever made. Applying a separate art from the artist mentality is fruitless when the artist is using their success to cause harm. It only serves to deny the real-life problems with still engaging in that media. While I used the Miku made blank template as an example, this same attitude is often stated in less ironic ways, which are, once more, somewhat missing the point. As I mentioned earlier, when the Activision news hit the circulation, one of the first trends to appear was Crash and Spyro, with a lot of people wishing that those two were owned by a different company, or that they could be sold to Nintendo, or Sony, or some other less publicly controversial developer. They may not be proclaiming that Miku made Spyro, but they are saying, "I wish somebody else made Spyro," which is basically the same idea with extra steps. It reflects a desire for a world where products and their creators are interchangeable, so one creator being problematic means you can simply swap them out with another, ignoring the fact that an artist will always be inherently intertwined with their creation. I totally get why fans may be upset when something they enjoy is owned by a terrible company, but when this kind of information is revealed, the energy should always be towards supporting the victims of those horrible practices, not, "How can I still buy the thing owned by the company?" When a well is poisoned, the number one goal should be to purify the spring and help the sick, not find a new place to sell the water, especially because it's very possible that the IPs singled out as the good ones have their own issues behind the scenes that haven't leaked yet. They're called systemic issues, not "this only happens to studios I already dislike" issues. As you can tell, I haven't really provided an easy answer for how one can still ethically support these companies, because there isn't really a truly innocent path. Buying a game directly from Activision will support harmful higher-ups who created a toxic environment. That is an unequivocal fact. If a Call of Duty game sells well, Bobby Kotick will get a big bonus. I'm not saying you can't support Call of Duty, I'm just saying, well... While I think the phrase "there is no such thing as ethical consumption under capitalism" is thrown around a bit too much these days, it has become a popular sentiment for a reason. For one example, the Political Action Committee for Taco Bell, of all companies, maxed out their donations to Donald Trump's presidential campaign back in 2016. Yeah, that guy kinda caused a lot of problems. Don't think he was the biggest fan of transgender people like myself, or any minority for that matter. But I work a service job in a miserable work or die world, so every now and then I will treat myself to a sweet, delicious Baja Blast, because one person buying one cup of soda is absolutely not tantamount to actually donating to the GOP. We don't choose to live in a capitalist society, but we need food and toiletries and clothes and distractions for survival, so we will all inevitably buy products from companies that have committed unspeakable horror somewhere on the planet. There's really nothing to be done in this case. Anyone who says they're able to fully avoid this critics are honestly lying to themselves. So, theoretically, buying a new Far Cry game from Ubisoft is not causing much more harm than buying something from Amazon or Walmart, companies that have caused much, much, much more harm than something as trivial as a game studio. With this in mind, though, there are two branching philosophies for how we can handle this information, which are kinda contradictory, but also both true. If this didn't seem complicated enough yet, oh boy. The first branch of this philosophy is accepting that every single corporation in the world has issues and nothing we consume can be truly pure. Ubisoft, Activision, and EA are the popular targets, but the same principle applies to the works of Nintendo, Sega, Capcom, Square Enix, and so on. Every single one of these companies can and should be criticized when due, and making games that people happen to like doesn't excuse anything. I mean, throwing myself under the bus here, I've made several videos about Nintendo games that I like, and I enjoy Final Fantasy VII enough to have cosplayed Aerith both in my icon art and in real life. I like these games because they are fun, and complex, and interesting to analyze, but I will not deny for a second that Nintendo and Square Enix have done a lot wrong. My 3D Mario retrospective is basically me reconciling my admiration of Nintendo's game design with their anti-consumer practices. Square Enix, the creators of Final Fantasy VII, have had issues with crunch and sexism just like Activision, as shown by this dark and telling Twitter thread from a developer of Final Fantasy XIV. The aforementioned Insomniac example is also relevant. The studio may have avoided crunch for the latest Ratchet & Clank, but this other Twitter thread recounts horribly sexist attitudes still being perpetrated in 2021. Art can be influential to your upbringing, or creative style, or friend group. Almost everyone in the world has been at least somewhat motivated by one form of media or another. This is normal, this is okay, this is important. But at the end of the day, they are also products of a corporation and should still be treated as such. You cannot look at any commercial work of art without accepting that it at least somewhat exists to make a profit, which isn't inherently bad, but often leads to exploitation for the sake of said profit. All of this is to say that, yeah, nothing in this world is free of issue, including the things you love, and that's fine. Accepting this reality allows one to say, this work has problems, but I can appreciate the good without inherently supporting the bad, which is absolutely a healthier and more honest mindset than simply ignoring or writing off systemic issues to avoid mild discomfort. That said, there is an opposing philosophy that branches from that same point, which is also very important to consider. Because yes, there is no such thing as ethical consumption under capitalism, but you don't need a video game to be alive. Unlike shelter or groceries or clothing, games are a luxury, like seeing a movie or going to a theme park. There are not really any cases where you need to buy a game to be alive. Can a series help lift your spirits and improve your mental health? Sure, that's fine and cool. Art exists to reflect one's mood and change one's outlook. But there are other outlets for self-improvement beyond just playing a video game. And basing your entire mental health on one fictional property owned by a company that cannot and will not reciprocate those feelings is a fool's errand in its own right. So using the no such thing as ethical consumption under capitalism argument doesn't account for the fact that, yeah, we all have to deal with shitty corporations in this modern day capitalist environment, but there are times where you can avoid buying a video game because there may be negative consequences to doing so. What especially bugs me about this mindset is how defeatist it is, essentially implying that there's no way you can succeed in this medium without abusing your workers, so there's no use trying to avoid it. Simply venturing out of the mainstream territory will almost immediately disprove this. There are certainly corrupt indie studios like Chucklefish and Decalus, and there are certainly bigoted indie creators like Scott Cawthon and Andrew Lanson, but there are just as many small-scale, small-budget projects that don't need to destroy the lives of their creators on a massive scale to make an enjoyable experience. The indie scene is vast and full of passion projects from diverse creators that don't need to follow content guidelines created by cishet white executives. The fact that Hades was produced by a team of 20 people with no crunch and ended up being one of the biggest games of 2020 is living proof that the mainstream games industry doesn't need to be the way it is. The film industry is not usually a great example for anything, but it has been around for quite a bit longer and has been given much more time to evolve. There wasn't always a screen actors guild, creators didn't always get residuals, and there weren't always unions in general. But the industry improved over time and all of those institutions got set in place. But you don't get those improvements by staying rooted firmly in the field of a single conglomerate, letting them do whatever they want. You get improvements by organizing, standing with workers, and occasionally voting with your wallets. There's no such thing as ethical consumption under capitalism, sure, but there are certainly options that are more ethical in a creative field that, again, is a hobby, which can be important in its own right, but is by no means required to be alive. We should be using these works as examples, not ignoring their existence in favor of looking Bobby Kotick square in the eyes and saying more, daddy-o. None of this is to say that mainstream games are inherently bad and you should feel bad for liking them, and that indie games are inherently good and you should feel good for liking them. Both are positively silly notions. But when a fictional IP is one's first priority, when horrible allegations hit, it shows companies that people love these series enough to care more about them than the real people they have hurt. It is very possible that Crash 5 or Spyro 4 will be announced in the near future, and millions of fans will already forget these horrible conditions that got the company sued in favor of mindlessly promoting a brand new product. This is already kind of happening with Overwatch 2. When characters are prioritized over human lives, said characters will be used as pawns in a company's corporate messaging, which is a disgusting use of art in its own right. With all of these arguments covered and analyzed, where do we go from here? Art is incredibly important to human life, so much so that it seriously is difficult to give up something that brought you a lot of joy in the past. I've been there myself. I used to be a Harry Potter fan. I read all the books, watched all the movies, and even worked at the theme park for about a year, but I simply cannot indulge in the series anymore knowing what J.K. Rowling is doing with their profits. I also enjoyed Mario plus Rabbids Kingdom Battle back in 2017, and was excited at the prospect of a sequel when it was announced earlier this year. Ubisoft is another blatantly horrible company, and I want to call attention to that, but one cannot erase the past positive association or joy they get from a work of art, even acknowledging that the product also has the capacity to spread harm. It is reductive to place a complicated and collaborative medium like gaming into a black and white, it's bad or it's good bin. It is also reductive to act like all corporations being bad means we can mindlessly put money into the pockets of horrible people. As contradictory as both of those statements are, they are both 100% true. So how does one reconcile that? One easy answer is to simply buy games used. That necessitates others buying the title, but it does give a mental peace of mind knowing that you're not directly giving money to a bad thing. Not a perfect solution, but an adequate one. Some people like to donate money toward a worthy cause alongside a problematic purchase, such as donating to a pro-trans charity after purchasing the upcoming Hogwarts Legacy, a sort of balancing the good and bad in the world type of thing. And the last option, besides the abstinence-only don't-buy-it-at-all choice, is to just suck it in and buy it anyway. Except that, yeah, this purchase is putting a tiny bit of bad into the world, however small it may be. That doesn't make you a bad person, but it's something to be aware of. In today's modern-day socially aware environment, many have become concerned with moralizing their own interests. It's part of why the word problematic has essentially lost all meaning. You can't like something that might be a tiny bit problematic because that means you're also a problematic, so instead you can only like something that is morally okay to exist. Activision bad, Nintendo good, thus Nintendo should own Crash so thing I like can be good again. But I think fandom would be a much healthier place if folks just admitted that the things they like may have some problems, whether it be in the text or behind the scenes. Accepting that Square Enix might have a problem with violence against women, or that Nintendo may have a staggering lack of diversity even in modern times, or that Rayman's creator may not be that great of a person. It is okay to pick apart the things you like. It can even be enjoyable in its own unique way, but in order for that to work, we cannot make the things we like a core part of our identity, because that means any critique of a work is a critique of oneself. There is a fine line between being passionate about an IP and making it a fundamental part of your identity. One is finding connection with art, the other is tying assigning worth to a product. One allows you to consume problematic media with nuance and a critical eye, and the other leads to one caring more about a fictional character than a real-life person. And there are absolutely no scenarios where the latter is okay. I know I've made this disclaimer a bunch of times by now, but I really do mean that still liking a work of art after it is found to have dubious origins does not inherently make you a bad person. We all have our exceptions, our childhood memories, yada yada yada, you get it by now. However, if there's one takeaway I did get from researching for this video, it's that it is important to have a limit. It doesn't need to be a defined universal limit between everyone, because most people have a different level of tolerance for real-life issues in their media. But as a whole, it is important to not just be aware of the issues within the media you consume, but to be vocal about it as well. You don't need to preface every statement of your opinion with a disclaimer of a work's problems, that would be exhausting, but when something does come out about it, don't sweep it under the rug just because it makes you feel uncomfortable. And at least consider that you don't always need to support something even if you like it, because at the end of the day, gaming is still just a hobby. So, is it okay to support problematic developers? It's not really a yes or no question. It all depends on how you define your support. If support means willfully ignoring a problem and uncritically supporting a company because you refuse to care, I would definitely raise my eyebrow at that. If support means a large publication reporting on exciting gaming news with no mention of a company's horrible culture, that is also a bit dubious in my opinion. But if support means consuming a piece of media while still being wary about the real-world problems surrounding it, there is no inherent issue to that. If support means not lying to yourself and accepting, yeah, this thing has problems, I will talk about the good and the bad, there is no inherent issue to that either. Obviously, there are nuances that depend on one's platform or identity or connection to the accused, but there is never going to be a one-size-fits-all answer to this. But there's one thing that should always be considered in these types of discussions. Video games are cool, but they're still video games. There are a lot of things in the world that are more important, and if the thought of playing a certain video game is making you feel guilty or bad, now might be a good chance to focus on one of those other things for a while. Video games will still be there when you get back,